यू सो मच फॉर कंफर्मिंग. एक्चुअली आई रियली अप्रिशिएट दैट, यू नो, मेनी ऑफ द पीपल आर कंफर्मिंग दैट. सो दैट काइंड ऑफ एंगेजमेंट आई लाइक वेरी मच बिकॉज इट इज वर्चुअल क्लासरूम. सो हियर दैट रेपोर, दैट इंटरेक्टिविटी इज लिटिल बिट डिफिकल्ट, बट थैंक्स टू यू पीपल दैट यू आर इंटरेक्टिंग. एंड आई रिक्वेस्ट यू टू, यू नो, कीप दिस रेपोर टिल द एंड बिकॉज टुमोरो ऑल्सो आई हैव द सेशन. टूडे ऑल्सो विल स्टेच अप टू 1 o'clock. So, as you know, sir has given already my introduction.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, can you please mute your microphone? Jinka bhi on hai wo. Yeah. Okay. Thank you so much. Sir has already given my introduction. Now, let me just tell you about, you know, how this company has emerged. Actually, there is a story behind that. That is why I wanted to tell you. 2 years back, when I was working as a senior consultant at one of the management consulting company, we used to go to the client place. So that was a company, and we used to, you know, take a round in the shop floor to see the improvement opportunities and how the progress is going on. During that, I have observed one department or one area where 8 to 10 people are sitting. Now those 10 people, so I curiously asked to the coordinator who is with me. He is a representative of the company. So I asked him that what these people are doing. So he mentioned that they are doing a data collection. So basically whatever reports that we are generating from the process, that what is the temperature, what is the pressure and everything, they write it in the register. And those people, who is the team of 8 to 10 people, what they are doing? They are doing data entry. So basically, they are entering into the system. It may be Excel, it may be their server. So I was more curious because I'm a person of data, because I like data. So I was more curious that how they are doing and what they are doing, I wanted to see. So I went and visited that department. So everybody was having one register and they are, you know, entering into the Excel and then they are uploading it to that, you know, common server. So I find it interesting. And then after few days, I was get a chance to have a meeting with management or to, you know, attend their management meeting. So usually they are discussing their routine strategy and budgeting and everything. So in that, I was a part of that meeting. So during that meeting, I have observed that they are not using the data which is collected at the shop floor. So there is a huge gap actually. So on the top, there is a superficial talkings are going on and all. Right, so whatever they are assuming, based on that they are taking the decision. They are not using the data which is collected and which is entered by the people. So there I found a gap, and at that time, you know, one idea strike into my mind that there is a gap between this you know, data collection and the usability of the data. So that I could not digest actually. And I strongly believe that if you are collecting any data, then it should be, or it must be used somewhere in the decision making, or you may say for the any conclusion purpose, right? So if you are not going to use those data anywhere, then don't waste your time, money and energy behind data collection, because whenever you are collecting the data, it costs to you. Okay, please remember, if you are collecting a single data, then it costs to you. It may be negligible, but it is costing to you. Now in that company, there are 8 to 10 people whose job is to just enter the data. Now you can imagine 8 to 10 people. It is a, you know, strength of a small organization. It is a, you know, size of the small organization that is, you know, working only for the data collection, and that data is not used anywhere. So that is one incident who motivated me to, you know, bridge this gap. And that is how this state modeler come into the picture, and then I started company last year. So sir has already given my introduction. I'm CEO and co-founder of this company. Last year we started this company, and previously I was working with one management consulting company since more than 8 years. And you know, by looking at this, whatever situation I had observed during my career, we come up with 4 domains of services. So the first one is our data science, where we are providing training and consultancy services for data science subjects like machine learning, RStudio, Python, SPSS, Minitab, Power BI, Tableau, and many more. Another one is operational excellence. So that is, you know, the aspect of the industry basically. So in industry, for the operational excellence, they're using Six Sigma, Lean, 5S, Kaizen, TPM, and everything. Now, what we do a blended approach. So in one company, in a one department, Six Sigma is applicable. In the same company, in another department, let's say TPM is applicable. In another department, Kanban is applicable. So basically what we do, we perform a gap assessment and we create a customized roadmap where, you know, the Six Sigma, TPM, Kanban, and everything is aligned so that, you know, speed of implementation can be fast. The third area where we are working is research projects. So it may be government-sponsored research project, it may be UGC-sponsored, it may be university-sponsored, it may be private project, or it may be, let's say, survey analysis, or it may be individual project, like somebody is pursuing PhD in that also, they are collecting data. And wherever they need help for the data analysis part, at that time we are helping them. Or sometimes it is, you know, marketing research projects are also there. And the fourth one, we are also collaborating with universities and the colleges where we are conducting workshops, training programs, and certification courses for the faculties as well as students. Now, you know, this data and all this thing is not limited to some particular area. So you can see here, well, these are the different fields from where we have a client. So either we have provided training or consultancy in all this area. So you can see, it started with the agroeconomics, and let's say there are plastic processing industries are also there. There is chemical industries are also there. Then mechanical engineering, home science even, and marketing management. So all the areas, wherever data is there, at that time, we can help them. Now, these are some of the snaps of the activity that we used to do. So these are the training on SPSS at BVM College of Engineering, Vallabh Vidyanagar. Then BASE says that training we provided at Department of Statistics, Sardar Patel University. And this is basics of Python in the same department we provided. You can see the crowd of the students. So more than 40 students were there. And this is role of SPSS at DDU Nadiad. Obviously, this all the snaps are before lockdown. So these are all the training on R. We provided training on R at Mumbai University, AERC, Agro Economic Research Center at Sardar Patel University, then Anand Agriculture University, HRDC, Gujarat University. So everywhere, you know, at all these places, we provided this training. Now, if I tell you, you know, something about our journey of online training. So during this lockdown, it is really a pandemic situation for everyone. So we started with this online training. So in the month of April, we conducted two training programs and so on, you know, up till September, this is the data. So you can see more than 30 programs we conducted online on different subjects that I just mentioned over there. And if I tell you about our team, then this is me. And this is my colleague Mehul Gandhi, who is business associate with us. Saurabh Chaudhary, who is also a business associate with us. Kapil Vanand, who is operating from London, UK, he is also business associate with us. And Dalit Alone, who is also business associate with us. Now here, one common thing that I would like to say proudly, that all these five people, which is in front of you, they all are from the Department of Statistics, Sardar Patel University. So they are product of that department. And this is information. I'll be sharing this presentation. So now we'll start our session in detail. Now, this is already sir has explained, so I'm just skipping that. Now, during this session, what we are going to see. So I hope this is covered, right? So scale of measurement, but I just try to, you know, recap it. I'll not go in much detail, but I'll just recap that so that I would like to align all the graphs with respect to the scale of measurement. And then we'll understand that what is the need of the data visualization, because today's topic is data visualization through R, right? Now, what are the different charts which are available? So out of that, we are going to see some of the important chart which are, you know, for the qualitative data and quantitative data. So bar chart, cluster bar chart, pie chart that we are going to see, and then histogram, box plot, scatter plot that we are going to see. And we'll see how to prepare these charts. So first of all, we'll just try to understand in which situation all these charts are applicable and you know, when to use it. And then we'll go ahead and make our charts in RStudio using the BASE package. And if time permits, we'll also use ggplot2 package. Right. So ggplot2 package also we are going to use. And then session wrap up will be there. A question and answer will be there. So this is how you know, we are going to go ahead. Now you know, before I move ahead, I would like to ask a participant that scale of measurement was taken by it is already taken, yes or no? Can anyone?
Yes, it has been covered. Yes, yes.
It has. Who covered that? The name of the faculty?
I don't remember exactly who covered it, but I think it was covered. It was some Raj Kundalia. Dharmesh.
Yes, Dharmesh Rai Kundalia. I think yesterday and day before yesterday, he was having the session, I suppose.
Yes. Santa, he is from Sardar Patel University.
Okay. So, yeah, because, if I know then where to start that, I can, start. Anyway, now, he might have shown the same slides, which I'm using right now. So, scale of measurement. So, there are basically two types of data, qualitative and quantitative type of data. If you divide this qualitative data into two parts, then nominal and ordinal are there. Quantitative data, interval and ratio are there, right? Now, this example, I just briefly tell you and then we'll move ahead. So, for example, if I'm, collecting a data of the color of this apple, that is red, green and yellow, right? So, this is nominal type of data because only, this is given for the identification. Now, there is no order or there is no values are there. Now here, this is, I've taken a bite on this apple and then I'm using this. I'm writing down this taste of this. So that is medium, sour and sweet. So this is ordinal data because I can organize this in a order. So sweet is better than medium and medium is better than sour. Now I don't know exactly how much it is sweet compared to the medium. So, there we can't quantify it, but yes, we can arrange it in a order. So that is why it is ordinal data. Now this is interval data where I'm having the date of harvesting of the apple. Now here I can also organize it in order as well as I'll also be able to find out the differences. Here difference is not possible, but here I can do that. So the difference between this and this is, let's say, 10 days. Here the difference is, let's say, it's 1 month, 30 days. And here the difference is, let's say, again, it's 20 days, right? So likewise, I can find out the differences. So but that is the interval data. And here, this is the ratio data. Now ratio data means what? So if you divide any number like 7 divided by 5, then it is coming to 1.4. Now this 1.4 is also having the significant significance, you can say, or you can interpret this properly. Like what I can say, so the green apple is 1.4 times heavier than the red apple. Okay, so that is how we can conclude that. Now here the difference between interval and ratio is, like in interval, the value of zero is not true, that is arbitrary value. For example, temperature. So temperature is something where I tell you that 0 degree temperature is there, then we can't say there is no existence of the temperature. As temperature is there, but it is measured at a 0 degree. So this is not true zero. But here in this case, let's say if we talk about the height. Now if I tell you that height is 0 degree, okay, then it means that there is no height at all or there is no object at all. So here the value of zero will be true and here it won't be true. That is only the difference. But no need to confuse between this interval and ratio scale, because in statistical analysis, if your data is interval or ratio, in both the cases, almost all the statistical and this graphical techniques are same. And why we are learning this scale of measurement? Because we want to select the right tool and technique, because all the statistical tools and graphical tools are having some basis that if data is this type, and then you should use this technique and this tool or the chart. Now, if I give you this nail and the screwdriver, and if I ask you to fix it up, then it will be difficult to fix this. And if I give you the screw and hammer, then also it is difficult to do that. Actually, if I give you like this, then it will be a correct combination or a right selection of tool is there so that you can fix it properly. So screw with the screwdriver and nail with the hammer, right? And that is why we are learning this scale. Scale is nothing but which is helpful to select the right tool. Now, is this example was covered? Pizza delivery system?
No.
Okay. So here, let's say customer ordered a pizza, right? And Domino's, they are giving the guarantee of 30 minutes or less. Now we collected a data of 1 month and we have found that the average delivery time is 22 minutes. Now, can we say that our on-time performance is great and our customer must be happy with us? Can we say that?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Okay.
Because it has ordered less than 30 minutes.
Okay. Yeah, everyone, actually few of the participants are replying. So I request everyone to please be interactive. I'll enjoy it.
No, sir, it can be conclusive, because if the data has large variance, then it is right. Not conclusive to tell that it is less than 30 minutes.
Correct. Yes.
Is the wire has some time, within 30 minutes, they have to reach it. Somebody waits for more than 30 minutes to get it free. In that case,
that's true. This is another angle. That is the beauty of all this graph and numbers and statistics, that it depends on how you are visualizing or how you are just trying to see what angle. It is like that, no? In Mona Lisa painting, famous painting of Mona Lisa, everyone is looking something different, emotions over there on her face, right? So it is a quite similar to that. Now see, here we have a two type of group, like some of the participants are feeling that yes, it is less than 30, so it should be great performance, or our customer must be happy with us. And some of the people are saying that no, it may not be the case. That's true. Now let us try to visualize the same detail. Here what I've done, I've just derived some of the measurement and keep in front of you. Now the same data I'm representing in the form of chart. So let's say this is the chart. Now here, this is the response time in minutes. So here this is 30 minutes. Here it is average, which is coming to 22 minutes, right? Since the data is a skewed data, there are several cases where you can say, let's say, here it like maybe it is 30 minutes, then it is 60 minutes, or it is 90 minutes, and here it may be, let's say, 110 minutes or so. Now, there are several people who have got their pizza delivered after 30 minutes. So these are those people. Okay. Now, even though our average performance is 22 minutes, then we can't say our customer must be happy with us, because what about this customer? Now, as sir has mentioned, that if 5 minutes is delay, but I'm getting my pizza free, then I don't have any issue with those 5 minutes. That's true as a customer. But here, if we think neutrally, then that situation is not preferable to this company, because company is losing money over there. So when we are performing this at that time, we just think neutrally, that what is the optimum point. So neutrally, if we see, then this is not the desirable situation by either company or the customer, right? Now here, why this is the situation? Because we are talking about the average. Now in descriptive statistics, you might have learned that this average, that is X bar, is affected by outliers, right? So when our distribution is normal, or it is supposed to be bell-shaped cow kind of thing, then average is most reliable. But let's say if it is a skewed, or there are some outliers. Now these are all the outliers actually, right? So if our outliers are there in our data, at that time this average is not that much robust. Okay. Now here, customer doesn't feel average. So that is what I wanted to convey. When we are practically using somewhere in some company or for some institute, at that time customer doesn't feel average. So we can't just conclude based on this average, because they feel variation. So along with this average, some variability measurement also has to be there, range or variance or standard deviation. Something has to be there so that we can have a clear picture, because this is showing the just a one dot. But actually, if the picture is like these, or it is like these, so that we can observe from the variability. Now practically speaking, this the last statement which I written, that customer don't feel average, customer feel the variation. Now to practically justify it, you ordered pizza 10 times. For the 6 times, you have got your pizza within, let's say, 15 minutes. Okay, and for the four times you have got your pizza at, let's say, 60 minute. Okay, and the average is coming, let's say, whatever average that is coming, which is less than 30 minutes. Okay, it may be 25 minutes, just for the example. Okay, now will you be 100% satisfied with the service of which is provided by the pizza company?
No.
Obviously
no,
not.
Sir.
Now that, no. Yes, that's true. So now you can't, pizza company representative or that pizza company can't claim that, madam, you can see here, the average is 25 minutes against the commitment that we are providing of 30 minutes. So you should be happy with us. But this is not we are feeling. What we are feeling is, we are feeling that against that 30 minutes, four times you have, you know, come at that 60 minutes. So that variation we are feeling, like six times you are coming at 15 minutes and four times you are coming at 60 minutes. So it is really not acceptable. Okay, so that is why, you know, any of the information, if you put it into the graph, then it will give you more insight. No doubt, these tables and these figures are also important. I don't say that it is not useful. But along with this, if you, you know, plot a graph, then it will be more, you know, sensible conclusions that we can draw from this graph. Now let me, you know, give you some of the, you know, this example, so that you can have idea that why data visualization is important and why we need to do that, because it is an immense part of any analysis. Sorry. Now here, I'm having a few numbers, and if I ask you that how many numbers are above 100, and if I give you 10 seconds of time, then it's very difficult to calculate that. Okay, and if I give you a more time, then you may, you know, find out this one, and then like when this one, and then this one, this one. Likewise, you know, you'll go and just check whether it is above 100 or not, and then you'll be able to do that, right? So there are total six numbers that you can you know, count over here. Now if I ask you that how many numbers are below 10, for example, so within 10 seconds it is very difficult to tell something. But if I give you a more time, then you may go to each and every, you know, this observation, and then just, you know, check that it is less than 10 or not, right? So it is a time consuming, basically. And wherever we are presenting, it may be a conference, it may be a management, it may be a department, it may be a student also. So at that time, it should be more effective, because if I, you know, show slide like these, numbers like these, and then I explain the importance of the values which are below 10, then you know, this people will search that where this is, where these are the important values, right? So it is very difficult. Now life is not that much simple that it will only ask the, you know, some of the things like above 100 or below 10 or something like that, right? Life is complex. So whenever we are collecting a data, it is a complex situation. So here we have this quadrant 1, quadrant 2, quadrant 3, and quadrant 4, right? So there are four quadrants are there. Now if I ask you that which quadrant is having the highest total, so if I, you know, make a sum of all this value, make a sum of all this value, all this value, and all this value, so out of this four total values, which one is having the highest? So it's again very difficult to tell. You have to go to each and every observation, make a total, and then you have to take a decision. Very time consuming. But how effectively we can show this? So let us see that. Simply, if I can use the conditional formatting, or in some of the cases it is also known as a heat map, so if I use that, then I can easily highlight those values which are, let's say, I want to highlight and I want to convey it to my audience. So to the audience, I would like to, you know, tell them that these are the extraordinary performances, for example, which is above 100. So you can see, you know, these are the six observations out of this total. Similarly, here also we can highlight those values which are below 10. So this is more effective way to represent the same thing. So ultimately what we are doing here, we are adding a flavor of visualization. Now visualization doesn't mean always it should be in a chart form. It may be, you know, some, you know, like many of the time organization chart is also there. Like, so there is some higher authority, and then if you come down, then there are, let's say, three departments, and then again you know, below that department there are some sub department or something like that. This is also graphically that you are, you know, representing. If you write the same in the paragraph form, or let's say in a you know, word format, or you know, in a piece of paper, then it not be that much effective, as well as it is not communicated properly. But here, if you draw like this, then it is most useful. So that is the power of visualization, you can say. Now here, the third example we had just seen, that which quadrant is having the highest total. So here the shades are given based on its value. So higher the value, darker the shade. It is like that. So here you can see most of the dark shades value are here. So you can easily say that this shade is having the highest total. Okay. Now it is a very old proverb, that is Chinese proverb actually. So the picture is worth 1,000 words. So one of the best way to understand any process or any data is to graph by using some relevant charts or the tools or some pictures, right? So that will give you more insights about the data. Now the graph will be able to convey you the trends, patterns, distributions, outliers, and everything that you will be able to identify from the graph easily. You can do that, right? Now another important example that I would like to give, for example, if I tell you that before 2 years I went to Goa and there I visited a coconut beach, and there the water was very clean, and even the beach was also very neat and clean, and the trees are very amazing, and there was a atmosphere is very great, and it was really awesome experience, and like that I am explaining you half an hour. Okay, so there are I think 25 plus people are there right now. So all the picture which is created in your mind, will it be same across all the 25 people about that coconut beach, or will it be different?
Everybody will have their own visualization.
Exactly. So all the people will have their own visualization power, and they will visualize accordingly. Now some of the people might have visited that, so in that reference they try to correlate what I am explaining. Okay, and accordingly their picture will be created. Now that is not my purpose. When I am explaining to you people, at that time I am conveying you the same message. I want to convey the same message, right? So but that is not my purpose to create different visualizations in everybody's mind. Okay, so what I can do is I can simply put a picture that okay, this is the place I'm talking about, and then whatever I want to highlight, that I can highlight that I'm talking about this. Likewise, I can highlight. So almost picture in all the people that will be almost same. Is it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so that is the power of visualization basically. So whenever you want to convey something, it is a most powerful way for the communication also. Now another example. So why I'm giving this example, it may have a theory also, like may theory be rakh sakta tha, but I didn't keep any theory over there. I've just taken some of the practical examples so that we can have a clear understanding of this, why this visualization is important for us. Now here I'm having a data of let's say growth of plant after using some chemical. Okay, and the plant growth is given in a centimeter. Now what you can conclude or what you can understand from this data? Can you make some inferences, or can you derive some important thing out of this data?
So there is not mentioned variable name.
Yeah, variable name is plant growth. Actually, it is plant growth in centimeter.
Okay. But this is just the simple data. We can't make out of it just looking at the data like this, right?
Yes. So this is it is a quite similar that we are collecting a raw data. For example, if you are conducting a survey or the experiment. So at the end of survey or at the end of experiment, we'll have some of the values, right? So which is in this format. It may be in Excel, it may be row, it may be column, but it should be this kind of bare numbers. Now, if you convert these numbers into some meaningful visualization, then majority of the things it will tell you. And then high-fi statistics, that is rarely required, because 80% of the conclusion that you can derive is from the exploratory data analysis, like descriptive statistics and this graph and charts and everything. If you make, then majority of the information that you are taking from that. Now after that, you just go for the hypothesis testing and building a regression model and everything. but majority of the thing that you can do with that exploratory data analysis. Now, if you convert the same chart in some, this kind of graph, now here histogram is made because it is a quantitative data. So histogram is useful. So here we have just made this. Now from this chart, we can conclude or we can derive many things. For example, center of the data. So here we can have this, mean that is coming to 2.92. And here also, we can find out it is somewhere here, because it is having the highest value. So this is the center of the data. After that, you can also derive the spread of the data, that is variation in the data. So it ranging from, let's say, 0.29. Okay, so that is the range of the data, you can say. Another measure, that is standard deviation, that is also given here in this box, that is 1.786. Other thing is shape of the distribution. Now, you might have observed that, shapes, a normal distribution and all. So here it is a right skewed data, because if you, look at this, then its tails is going towards the right direction, right? So it is a right skewed data. Or many of the time it is also known as a positive skewed. Another thing that you can also identify the outliers. Now here you can see, this is something, it may be like growth of the plant is, preferable for us, or it is, let's say, higher the growth, it is a good impact of that chemical, that is also we can conclude. But this is not the, behaving like all the other observation. It is falling here as a kind of a outlier. Okay. Now here, if it is a good situation, if outliers are good for us, then also we must know the reason why we are getting this highest value. Is there any, change in the proportion or any other additional treatment that we had given to that particular plants, so that we can repeat it and we can, take this to the further improvement. So that is the outliers also we can, find out by doing the visualization. And we can also have the count of the data, like this is, 100 data points are there. Now, these are the limit, like this is the 5 minimum information that you can get from the histogram. So whenever you see the histogram, you should always ask these 5 questions: the center of the data, spread of the data, shape of the data, and outliers, if present or not, and count of the data. Now here, some additional also you can, get. What? So for example, if our target is to have 5 cm or more, that is our target, right? So here, by looking at this graph, we can, draw a line over here. Okay, this is the 5 cm. Now, how many points are there which is above 5 cm? So here, let's say this frequency is 5, 5, and 2. So that is 12 observation out of 100. That is 12% of the plant are having growth which is greater than 5 cm. Now, here it is 5 cm, but you can take any point. So let's say if it is less than 2, then it is worst. So how many observations are there, so that you can easily find out from here. Okay, so if you, make a simple graph, then also you'll have so many information that you can derive from that single graph. Now there are, different types of charts actually. So all the charts are having different purposes and different, logic behind it. So let me, draw some of the charts. Okay, now what is the name of the first graph? This one,
simple bar diagram.
Simple bar chart, right? Okay, many of the time it is also known as a column chart. In Excel also you see that bar chart and column charts are there, so ultimately it is same. You are just swapping the axes only, but bar chart or the column chart, it is same here in this case. So simple bar chart. Now when we are using this, Now here my purpose will be like when to use it. So when to use it?
For two groups, cluster data.
Okay, I'm talking about this one, first chart only, simple bar chart.
Okay. When this information is given for individual respondent, or we have different information for different people.
Okay.
Sir, when the values are basically related to only one characteristic or variable, then only we can use this type of bar diagram. And this is also for discrete data, because I think for continuous data, bar diagram is not so much used.
Exactly, sir. You mentioned the right thing. The first condition is one variable. Now, variable, it may be a characteristics or it may be the information that you are collecting, right? So, for example, if you are collecting a gender, so gender is one variable. Okay. Now, as sir has rightly mentioned, that it is used for, let's say, qualitative data. I'll be using this terminology, that qualitative data. Okay. Qualitative data means it may be nominal, it may be ordinal. It may be like gender, it may be, let's say, high, medium, low kind of thing, or it may be, if I ask you that which color do you like most, so many of the people will say, let's say, red, green, blue, white. Likewise, it may be there. Or if I am asking you that, where are you from? So many of the people will say, we are from, let's say, this state, we are from this state, we are from this state, we are from this state. Okay. So this all information are, let's say, qualitative information. It is not quantitative information. Okay. So as rightly mentioned, it is a discrete kind of thing. So one variable and qualitative information is there. At that time, we can use this simple bar chart. What is the name of the second chart?
Multiple bar diagram.
Okay. Now there are several names that also I would like to mention. So if you read somewhere, then you should not get confused. It is also known as a clustered bar chart. Many of the time it is also known as a group bar chart. Okay, now when to use it?
Sir, it is for the cases where two variables are there.
We are comparing two variables or something.
Correct, very correct. So comparing two variables, right? So two variables. So we want to compare them. And what will be the type of those variables? So here you have mentioned, no, that qualitative data will be there or discrete data will be there. So here, what will be the type of those variables?
I think we can use both type of variables, right? Like growth, if you want to measure the growth rate of any two states or a particular region or a particular plant or industry, something, or income of two, like male, female, like that, right? How much in a particular year a male is earning or a female is earning. Maybe it's in that sense. Can we use it?
You can customize. Many of the softwares are giving that freedom, that on y-axis. Now, basically, when it was designed, these charts were designed, at that time on y-axis, there is count, basically the frequency. So how many, now if I again talk about the simple bar chart, then that's how many people who like red color. So here it would be, for example, let's say three people, here two people, five people, likewise it will be there. So these are the basically the count. Now here also, initially when it was designed, it is the count. So for example, I'm having people from Gujarat, Maharashtra, Rajasthan. So that is one variable, that is state. Another variable is, let's say, gender. So how many male are there, how many female are there, how many male are there, female are there, male are there, female are there, right? So here it will be a count only. Now this will be for the discrete, or you can say qualitative information. Now many of the softwares give you the freedom that you can also, instead of this count, you can also put the average. Like as you rightly mentioned, that income or some in the plant growth or something like that. That is also you can do that. But here on the y-axis, this both the variable that is supposed to be of categorical or the qualitative or discrete. These are all the different names of the same type. So qualitative, categorical, or let's say discrete type of data. So here we can't put plant growth or something like that on the x-axis. So there has to be a categorical data. On y-axis, you may, you know, use any of this this information like average, minimum, maximum count, or anything else. Now, what is the name of the third chart?
Pie chart.
Pie chart.
Very famous chart.
Yes.
Pie chart. Yes. So it is. You can say it is a brother of the simple bar chart. Okay. So whatever situation here is there, one variable, qualitative information, same will go here. But here our purpose is to, you know, show some data in the percentage, and here we show some data in a count. So that is only the difference. Otherwise, here also, like how many red, blue, green. So this slicing, how it is done? It is done based on some qualitative variable. It may be state, it may be gender, it may be region, it may be anything. But here our focus is to show in the form of percentage, that how much it is you know, covering. So that is what we are using. Now, if you, you know, look at the pattern of the three graph that we just discussed now, that simple bar chart, multiple bar diagram, and this pie chart, it is mostly dealing with the qualitative data. Qualitative data, or you can say categorical data, or let's say discrete type of data. Now, this is not the case always. So there has to be some, you know, charts which are useful for the quantitative data also. So what is the name of the fourth chart? I'm just, you know, removing all this upper information.
Right?
Yeah, histogram, correct, correct. So the fourth chart is histogram. Let me just you know, remove this so that we can use this. So this is known as a histogram. When to use it?
Sir, you for the continuous variable.
Continuous variable. Or you can say quantitative variable. Okay. Now, here, for example, if I'm collecting a age of the respondent, right? So that is in a row format. I'm not giving any category like from 15 to 20, 20 to 25. I'm not asking in that way. I'm asking them to write down their age. So it may be numbers only, right? Now in that case, I can't make a bar chart because let's say 100 people are there. There may be chances that, you know, the variants are different. Let's say it ranges from 22 years to let's say 65 years. So all this, you know, age will be there. Now in that case, if I go and make a bar chart, then here it will start with 22, 23, 24. Likewise, it will go to, let's say, 65 years. So you can see how many bars will be there, and it is very difficult to conclude anything from this one. Okay. So in that case, what we have to do, we have to make a histogram. Now, what histogram will do? Basically, it will, you know, find out the minimum and maximum value, and then it will decide.
Interval or something, right?
Interval. Yeah, it will decide the intervals. That's true, very true. So interval, or you can say bin size. So it will, you know, by default it will do that, and then it will represent the data. Now how it is done? So basically, let's say 100 observations are there. Now you know, minimum value is let's say 20 years, and maximum value is let's say 70 years. Okay, the age of the respondent we have taken. Now ideally, you know, there is a very crucial question that how many bars should be there. Now how many this bar should be made, right? So there is no fix you know, this thing. You can, you know, always deviate between them, but there is a rule of thumb. Ideally, how many bars should be there? So there are some, you know, formulas are also there, but let's say rule of thumb is, if you, you know, make a root of n, right? So that is root of 100, then how many is there? So 10. Okay, now the 10 bars you can, you know, create over here, 10 bins you can create over there. So that is sufficient to visualize the thing. Now, in that reference, what you can do, you can, you know, use this 10 bins and then whatever difference is there. For example, here the difference is 50 years, right? And if you divide this with this, you know, 10, then it is coming to 5. So it will, you know, start with this 20 to 25, 25 to 30, and so on. And how many people are there out of this 100 who is from 20 to 25? So let's say these are the people. And likewise, this, you know, this formation will be done. So this is the logic behind the histogram. Now I'll also talk about its you know, shape and everything. So let us first of all, you know, create this, complete this box plot and everything, and then we'll discuss about the shapes and all. Now the this is the histogram which is used for one variable, which is continuous. Okay, now another one is, what is the name of this? What is the name of this chart?
Box plot.
Box plot. That's very true. This is also known as a candle chart. If you are, anyone is, you know, familiar with the share market, then in share market it is known as a candle chart. But the funda is similar. Now, whenever, let's say here I'm having the age of the respondent, which is I have just, you know, shown in you this histogram. But I'm also having the data of, let's say, state. Okay. Now I want to use both this thing. In that case, what we can do, either, you know, I can create a different histogram, like this is from, let's say, Gujarat people, their age, Rajasthan people, their age. Likewise, let's say if 10 states are there, then I'll have to make a different 10 histograms. Or let's say in the same histogram, if I go and make, that is also in some of the software, it is that provision is there. So how it would look like? So let me show you how it is, you know, become messy. So let's say this is one group that you have just drawn, that is, let's say, from the people of the Gujarat. Then I'm using another color, because in the this visualization also you'll get this kind of color. Now this red color representing to the another state, let's say Maharashtra, or let's say this another color I'm taking. This is coming like this. And there is a fourth state, let's say. Now, if I ask you to conclude something from this chart, then will it be possible?
No, it's getting haphazard over there.
Exactly. Now, here in this case, the one option is we can, you know, make this, but it is not advisable. Another option is I can, you know, make different charts. How many state categories are there, and then I can compare them, which one is having the highest variation, which is having the lowest variation, which is having the let's say center value is maximum, center value is minimum. That all I can do by, you know, plotting this individual, but that is very time consuming. Now in that case, what we can do, we can use this box plot. Now here in box plot, how it is constructed, so basically on the x-axis it is taking the categories. So in this x axis, it is taking like Gujarat, Maharashtra, Rajasthan, or whatever states are there that it is taking. On the y axis, it is taking, let's say, your age, right? So here it will, you know, start like age is starting from some point, then it is the starting point, and then it will form a box which will also show you the distribution. Now we'll also go into the detail of each of the component, like in what is this line, what is this line, what is this line, what is this line, and what is this line. And if many of the time in box plot, you might have seen this kind of, you know, star marks over there. So what are those star marks? That also we are going to discuss. But now this is the situation, then you can use this box plot where one categorical variable is there and one continuous variable is there. And we want to compare them. So we want to make a group wise comparison. So at that time we can use this. Now the last chart that we are just going to discuss is this chart. What is the name of this?
This scatter diagram, right?
Yes, scatter diagram. Now, why we are using this scatter diagram? So in some of the situation, we may find two continuous variable are there. Two continuous variable or two quantitative variables are there. And we are assuming that they might have, or we are, you know, expecting some relationship between those two continuous variable, such as height and weight, demand and supply, rainfall and the crop, So these are, you know, all the continuous variable, but we want to check the relationship between them. So what we can do, we can use a scatter plot where this x-axis will hold the independent variable, and here it will take a dependent variable, right? And then you plot this scatter plot, and then you'll find whether the relationship is there or not. It is positive or not. It is negative or not. It is no relation or what. So that kind of all these things you can do with the scatter diagram. Okay. Now we'll also talk more about this scatter diagram, like its pattern and its you know, everything. So now let us move ahead. So whatever just we discussed is I mentioned over here. So all these charts are there. Now this, you know, bar chart already we have discussed. So I'm just keeping this theory part because that whatever I wanted to convey, that I conveyed during this slide. So I'm just skipping this and we'll go to the R before, you know, doing all these things. But I want to explain something about histogram, box plot, and the scatter plot. So I'm just going to that slide. Yeah. Now in histogram, basically it shows the relative frequency of the data value, and it indicates the center, spread, and shape of the data. Now many of the time, you know, as I mentioned, that you have some, you know, customer requirement or the target value. So you can easily compare against that. So here, let's say this is the histogram. Here it is a frequency, and here it is the you know, bins. And our let's say this management requirement is, let's say, 8 hours. OT should not be greater than 8 hours. Then we can draw a simple line over here, and then we can count these frequencies, that how many time it is going beyond the target. So that is very easy to compare here in the histogram. Now, you know, wherever you are seeing any histogram, you should always ask 5 questions. The first is center of the data, then spread of the data, shape of the data, outlier of the data, and the number of observation in the data. So these are the 5 basic information that you can immediately get from the histogram. Now for the box plot, if I tell you, then you know, this box plot is also used to, you know, compare the, you know, shape and the center and spread of the data, and it will look something like this. So if you are, you know, making it for only a single variable, like age of the respondent, there are 100 observations, and if you make, then it may come like this. But let's say the age is given and we are having the state as a categorical variable, and we want to compare the group, then it will look something like this. Okay. Now, if you look at the elements of the histogram, this box plot, then this is known as an outlier because it is, you know, falling beyond the range, like below the range or above the range, then it is said to be an outlier. Outlier may be on the downside or it may be on the higher side. So these are nothing but the extreme values, you can say. Now, this is the lower limit. This point is nothing but the lower limit. Now, this point in the box is nothing but your Q1, that is quartile 1. Or in other words, you can say it is 25th percentile. So what we can conclude from this? So let's say out of, you know, this 100 data points, 25 data points will have, you know, the value which is below or equal to this value. So here it is, you know, the value is coming, let's say 18, right? So out of total 100 observation, 25 observation will be there whose value is, let's say, less than or equal to 18. So that will be here. Now, if you look at the middle line, then it is said to be a median, or many of the time it is said to be a Q2, that is quartile 2, or it is also known as a 50th percentile. So that means you are, you know, cutting your data from the middle. So it is median. So 50% of the data will be this side, below this value, and 50% of the data will be above this value. And what is the this third line? So that is nothing but Q3, that is 75th percentile. So 75% of the observation will be below or equal to this line, and only 25% observation will be above this line. And this is known as an upper limit. Now, how this upper and lower limit is calculated, that also I'll tell you. So basically, in a construction of box plot, you are folding your data 4 times, or you are dividing your data into 4 segments. So you are cutting it from the middle. So 50% here and 50% here will be there. And then again, you are folding. So 25% here, 25% here, 25% here, 25% here. So likewise, it is organized. Now, if we look at the example, then let's say I'm having a data of, you know, year of experience. So 4, 4, 5, 6, 8, 8, 8, 9, 9, 9, 10, and 12. Now I want to construct a box plot from this. How can I do that? So first of all, I'll calculate the median. That is the middle point. So I can, you know, divide my data into two parts. That is 50% here and 50% here. So median is coming to 8 plus 8 divided by 2. That is 8. Now, again, I'll divide this into two parts. So here, the you know, it is 5 and 6. So 5 plus 6 divided by 2. That is coming to 5.5. So here, this is 25%. Here, 25%. Another. And now, again, I have to divide this one. So what I'll do, 9 plus 9, that is 18. 18 divided by 2 is 9. So now this is 25% and this is 25%. This is how we can, you know, divide our data into four part. And now using the same information, we can derive the box plot. So here I have mentioned the scale, which is, you know, from 4 to 12. And the scale is always something like that, which include your minimum and maximum value so that it can you can show that value in the graph. Now here this box is prepared. So here you can see this point is Q1, that is 5.5 here. So that is same thing which is mentioned over here. This is 8, which is mentioned over here. This is 9, which is mentioned over here. And then these are the lines. Now how these lines are coming? By using this formula. Lower limit is coming by Q1 minus 1.5 times of Q3 minus Q1. Now this is called interquartile range. So the difference between Q3 and Q1, that is known as a interquartile range. And by using that interquartile range, you are getting this lower limit and upper limit. Okay. So based on that, it is calculated. So any of the point, let's say here some observation is there, let's say 50. So it may be, you know, act as an outlier and it will show you like this. So you will have a clear cut idea that outlier is there in our data. So we should either, you know, remove that or we should study that, whether it is a data entry error. So instead of 5, we have entered this 50, or it is a real value, right? So that we can check, and we can, if it is, let's say, data entry error, then we should correct it. And let's say if it is a real value, then we have to, you know, observe that our sample is drawn from this population. And then why this much of, you know, variation is coming there? So if it is not required, we can remove it. So though it will not disturb our data point. It will not disturb our analysis basically. Now, if you compare this box plot with histogram, then let's say this is the box plot and this is the histogram. If you anti-clockwise 90 degree, if you, you know, turn your histogram, then it will, you know, look like this. Or you can, you know, tilt this box plot, then also it will be perfectly fine. Sorry. And here it may be a histogram, right? So we can just compare this, both of them. So here you can see this outlier is also shown in the histogram, and here it is also shown. This is the, you know, lower limit. Here also it is showing the lower limit. Most of the points or the center of the data is here, and here also the center of the data is coming here. And here also it is a lower limit. So likewise, we can compare. But box plot is useful when we want to compare the strata or the groups, and we want to easily identify this outlier. Here it may be a dilemma sometimes. Sometimes some patterns are there in which you may feel that it is outlier, or I may feel that it is not outlier. But in box plot, it is clearly denoted with the star mark. So it is outlier for you as well as me. So there is no difference of opinion to decide the outlier. Now, if you, you know, look at the differences between box plot and the histogram, then you know, this box plot is used to compare the two groups, two or more groups, sorry, right? So where we are having the group data at that time, we can use this. And then histogram is used to study the exact shape of the process or shape of the data. Here in the box plot, we can't see the exact shape of the data. It is based on the median and interquartile range. So we have just seen the construction of this box plot. So median is there, and then interquartile range is there, which denotes the center and spread of the data. But a histogram, it is based on the mean and standard deviation, average and the standard deviation. Now box plot does not tell you about the exact shape of the data. So like if there are, let's say, two modes, in many of the data you may find like this. Okay, so there are two modes actually. So now this pattern is not normal, but it is something like that. But here in this case, how box plot will look like? So box plot maybe look like this only. Now it will not tell you that, okay, there are, you know, two peaks are there. Or it may be, you know, if this is another case. Here also the box plot would be same. Okay, so box plot will not be able to tell you that is there any more than two modes or what. But the histogram will easily tell you the exact shape of the data. Now here in the box plot, it is very difficult to, you know, make out that how many observations are above or below some particular value. So in histogram, I can tell you that how many, let's say this is 5 centimeter of growth, and I can easily count that how many are above this 5 centimeter. But in the box plot, it's very difficult to, you know, tell that how many are above this value, because these values are not shown in the form of graph or this bars or anything else. So these are only the points that it will tell you. So in that way, histogram will be useful. So that is the basic difference between box plot and histogram. Now we'll jump into the R. So we'll you know, prepare all this graph over there. Let me describe this. Yeah, so please open R. So you also have to do along with me so that you can have idea that how it is done. Okay, once you open the R, you can just tell me. You can also mention in the chat box. Okay, so yes, please, everyone, once it is open, mention in the chat box so that we can move ahead. And yeah, up to this point, if you have any query, then please ask so we can discuss that, and then we'll move ahead.
Sir, just one clarification.
Yes.
Sir, whenever we draw the box plot, suppose we are calculating the upper limit and lower limit. So according to the calculation, there is a possibility of multiple outliers, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, definitely. There are possibility of multiple outliers.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Okay. So I hope everyone has opened the R. And now let me go to the R studio here. So you might have this kind of screen. Now to open a new file, what I'll do, I'll go to this file menu and then this new file and then R script, or you can use the Control Shift N, that shortcut also you can use to open a new file. Okay, now this is already I think it had been covered. This is a script file, this is console, this is environment, and this is the place where we'll get the output. Now let me open the script file which I prepared for you people. So I'll at the end I'll share this one, the presentation which I'm using, as well as the file that I prepared for you, so that I'll you know, share with you. Now here I have just kept it open, and I'll just try to type all the code so that I'll also explain you how it is, you know, being done actually. So it is just for reference, I'm just keeping it open. Now here, the data set that we are going to use, that is from the library MAS. So what you have to do, you have to call the library first. So library MASS. So library MAS is there. That first of all, you have to load. So please do along with me. Library into bracket MASS. That is supposed to be in a capital. Okay, so you just run that. Now, whenever you are getting any error, just let me know, huh?
For run, we have to press Control R.
Control Enter, madam. In R Studio, in R Studio, control enter is there, but if you are using R, then it's control R.
I'm using R Studio, sir.
Then control enter, madam.
Control enter.
Yeah, control enter.
Okay, fine. Control
enter. Yeah.
Okay,
fine. And there is another option. For example, if you can see here, run is run. There, right? You can click on that also. That is also perfectly fine. Let me increase the size. Okay. Now I'll move slowly, and then if you are getting any error, then just let me know. I'll wait for you and solve your queries. Now here, one data set is there in the mass library called survey. So let us first of all see what that survey is saying. So survey is the data set that we are using. Now if any of the function for that we want to see the help, then we can use this question mark and then type the function. So let's say, for example, if I type this mean, okay, and put a question mark over there, then it will tell you about the arithmetic mean. All the help file will be there. Now similarly, if I put here survey, and then if I run this, then it is showing me the details of that survey data set. So it is basically from the mass library, and it is a student survey data. So this data frame contains responses from 237 statistics 1 students at the University of Adelaide to the number of questions. Now what are the number of questions that we have asked to the student about their gender? And that is a factor, that is categorical data, male and female. And then we have asked them their writing hand span. So let me on my camera so that I can explain you this, what this information. Okay. Now what do we mean by the writing hand span? So if I am the, let's say, righty, right? So this is my writing hand, and now the span of this writing hand is nothing but the distance from this thumb to the little finger. So that is the span. So what is this in centimeter? So let's say it may be 18, it may be 19, it may be 20. So that measurement has been taken. So that is writing hand span, or writing hand span in centimeter, you can say. Now, since I'm writing, since I'm righty person, what is my non-writing hand? So that will be my left hand. Okay. So this left hand, what is the span of this? So that is the non-writing hand span in centimeter. So both the observations are taken from me. So let's say I'm a student, then both the observations are taken from me. My gender, that is male, that is written over there, then span is written over there. Then whether I'm righty or lefty, so that information is also stored. So let me just show you. So here this is writing hand, this is non-writing hand, then this is writing hand. So here it is again a category, like whether left or right. Okay. And when all the students are asked to fold their arms, so how they are keeping, so right on left, or left on right, or let's say neither, right? So likewise the data was collected, then pulse rate was measured. So it is in a beats per minute that was measured. And then all the students are asked to clap. So how it has clapped? So right is on the top, or left is on the top, or neither. So that information has been collected likewise. Then they also asked that how the exercise or what is the level of exercise that you are performing. So many of the student has done like frequently. Some people are saying that they are doing some time and they are doing none. So these are the three categories we have in the exercise. And they are also asked that do you smoke? So they had given the answer like heavy smoker, regularly smoker, occasionally smoker, and never smoker. So these are the four level that is received for this question. Now they're also taken the height of the student in centimeter, and then there is last option, which is it is in a metric, or it is in a imperial study. So it is in feet and inches, or it may be in a centimeter and meter. What is the unit has been used, that is metric or imperial, and the age of the student. So these are the information that has been collected from the student. Now what we are supposed to do, let us create a object, that is I'll be calling here df, that is data frame. You can give any name. For example, if I want to give Hiren, then also it is fine. So I'm giving a name that is df, and I'm storing all this data which is available in the survey. So I'll use this assignment operator, that is less than and dash sign, and then I'll be writing this survey. Okay, now by performing this, what I will get? I will get my data is copied in this df object. Now how can I verify that? So if I go to this environment, then df will be there, this kind of this, right? So df will be there, and here 237 observation and 12 variables are there. Now if you click on this df, then it will, you know, show you like this. So this is a gender, writing, and all the variables that we had discussed, that is mentioned over there here, and there are total 237 observations. Okay, so up to this point, are you all with me?
Yes sir.
Okay. So yeah, if anything is not, let's say my purpose is to take you all people with me. So if you are anybody is, you know, running behind, then just let me know. I'll hold and get you.
Sir, can I take a 2 minutes loo break?
Sure, madam. Is there any predefined break? Like everyone is.
We were supposed to take 5 to 10 minutes break in if the participants and the resource person are willing. I am willing to take a 2 minutes break, sir.
Not an issue. Do one thing. All the people can take 5 minutes of break. So it is 11:45 or 46. Within 5 minutes, please all come together and then we'll move ahead.
Thank you so much, sir.
Sure, sir.
Yeah. Okay, so can we start now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, okay. So let us go ahead with the R. I have shared a link to download the material. So you can download the entire material. Now, here we have stored our data in the DF object. Now, whenever we want to use this data, at that time we have we'll use this DF instead of that survey. Okay, so let us have a look at the structure of the data. So str, that is structure of the data, and then df. So what it will do, it will tell you about the structure of the data. So here, since it is, the size is more, so here this sex, writing hand, non-writing hand. So you can see here all these details are given. This is vector, this is number, this is number, this is vector, integer, and likewise it is given. Now we can also have a look at the head command, right? So head df, so it will display you the first six observation of the data frame. So six, writing hand, non-writing hand, and then it is 1 to 6, right? Now first of all, we would like to make a simple bar chart. Now this hashtag is used to comment the hashtag is used to add comment to the RStudio. So let's say this is not the code actually. This is the comment that I have used, that after this point, whatever code is written is for the simple bar chart. So in that case, we can use the hashtag. Now, if you look at the bar chart, then it is basically a frequency with reference to the category. So here, in this case, we are having some variables. Let's say we want to check how many, let's say this writing hand is there, right? So how many righty are there and how many lefty are there? So that we want to see from this data set. So how can we do that? So first thing, we have to make a table like which is showing the count, like this many people are righty and this many people are lefty. So for that we will make a table. So this table, I'm using the command called table itself. So table into bracket, I'll be using that column. So now to use that column, there are several ways to do that, but to make it more easy, what I'll do, I'll use this df, because I want to access the column of this data frame, and then I'll put a dollar sign, right? The shift 4, so that is dollar sign. So as soon as you put dollar sign, you'll have all this variables which is there in the data frame. So from here, I'll select the fourth one, that is writing hand. Okay, you for a trial purpose, you can pick anyone, but at this point of time, you just follow me. So we'll have the same output. Otherwise, you can take any of the categorical variables. Now, as soon as you do this and you click enter, you can see here on the console, we are getting the information that lefty are 18 and righty are 218. Okay, but to make a bar chart, we should store this in some object. So I'm calling it A, for example, because temporary I am just storing it. So this information, this table, basically I'm storing in the object called A. And whenever we want to store any value, we use this assignment operator. So we are assigning the value which is on the right side. So on the right side, these values are there that we are assigning to the value which is mentioned in the left side. So A is the left side. So this value will be stored in the A. So let me run that by pressing Control A. Now you can see here in the environment also, the A will be there, and the format for that is a table. Now whenever we want to fetch this information, we'll not write this syntax. What we'll do, we just simply write A and run this, and we'll have the same output. Okay, now it is very simple to make a bar chart. So to plot a bar chart, we have the command bar plot. Now this is the beauty of RStudio, that as soon as you type three characters, so let's say BAR, three character I have typed. Now, it will auto suggest whatever is starting from the BAR, right? So Bartlett is also starting from BAR, so it is also showing us. So bar plot, so let us select that. Now to select that, you can press enter or you can press tab. Now here it is asking for the data or the height. So we have to simply provide the A, because our data table is stored in the object called A. So let us store A over there and then just press enter. like not enter but control enter, just run that and you'll have this kind of graph over there. So please do up to this level and then mention done in the chat box and then we'll move ahead. Okay, great. So almost.
I got in the form of clustered bar chart form.
Then you might have used some other variable here. Please make sure you're using here w.hnd, that is lefty or righty.
Okay.
You might have used the wr hand, that is writing hand span.
So actually, my problem started from there only when we did that, na? Right hand $wr.
Yes.
The thing which came in the console, you left 18 people and right. That part didn't came in my console.
Yeah. So that is you selected a wrong variable and that is why it is coming. Yeah. Okay, just correct it and then run, it will run.
Okay, fine.
Yeah. Now this is very simple bar chart which doesn't have any X label, Y label, color or any header or something like that. So that is the basic.
Sir, I have also done the same mistake. So to correct this, I should put that variable B or any other name other than A.
You can do anything, but here itself you can what you can do now. Whenever you are doing this kind of mistake, you just go to this place. You can see my screen, right? So here, just go, delete this, again write this df dollar, and then select this fourth one, that is whnd, and then run this. So it will again, it will replace that A. You don't need to create a separate one.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. So whenever you are committing a mistake, please remember you can go to this code and correct your mistake, and you can run from that line itself. And this bar plot, so bar plot is coming now. We want to beautify this. Okay.
Yeah, it came first. I did the correction. It came like that.
Yeah.
The
one. Yeah. Okay. Correct. Okay. Now we want to beautify this chart by adding some headers and labels and all. Now here in R, you can in a single line, like all the arguments will be separated by comma. So here we have given the data. Now we would like to give a title. So for the title, the argument is called main, M-A-I-N, main. As soon as you type that, it is showing like this, main equal to, and what is the purpose of it? So overall and subtitle for the plot. So that we want to select. So let us select that, and then we will type that this is bar chart of writing hand. Okay, whatever title that you want to give, that you can give it over here. But you can see, as I keep my screen very large, or I keep it very zoom, you'll not be able to see the syntax entirely. So what I can do is, I can from after putting a comma here, I can press enter, so it will go to the next line. Okay, so in that way, many of the time you are writing a long syntax, so not necessary it should be in a single line. After putting a comma, you can take it to the next line. Okay, so here I have added one argument. So here this is the data that I have given, this is the title that I had given. Now again I put a comma and then press enter, and then I can write down x axis label, because that is the writing hand, right? So that I would like to write over there. So x l a b. So as soon as I type three character, it is suggest that label for x axis. Okay, so just press tab, so it will auto complete, and then here I can mention that it is a writing hand information. Okay, and now whenever you want to enter text, so this is the text information that we are adding. So all the text will go into the double quote or single quote, both will be interpreted as a text. Now similarly, I also would like to add into the Y label, so Y L A B, and then I can write down that it is a count. Okay, so you know, to run this, what you can do, I can go to this first one or I can be at the last one. So you can be any of the point. So here I can be at any line. Okay, it may be first line, it may be second, third, fourth, any of the line. And then if you press Control Enter or click on the run, then this will be, entire code will be run. So no need to, you know, each and every time, no need to select this and then run. No need for that. You can simply, you know, put your cursor anywhere in the code and then you can run this. It will be coming there. So please do till this point and then we'll move ahead. You may have this kind of output.
Yes, got it.
Yes, everyone, please, I'm just waiting for one more minute so everyone can align. Yeah. Great. So I really appreciate that you all are interacting. It gives us a motion. Thank you. Okay. Now I'll tell you something about making more beautiful. Like this color, I don't like this gray color. Okay. So what I'll do, I'll put a comma and add some more argument, that is col. Now you can see here, a col is equal to what it is written over here. So that is the beauty. If you are a beginner to the R, then what you can do by typing it, you can just read this function. You'll have almost idea about that argument or the function. So a vector of colors for the bars or bar components. Okay, so it is basically asking for colors. Now it may be also a vector. Vector means we used to write in the form of like say, c, and then we mention the color. But initially let me use only single color that I will would like to convert this into, let's say, blue color. So I'll type this blue in this double quote. Since it is a textual information, we have to type in a blue. And then if I run, then my bar chart will be turned into the blue color. Now, another argument that we can add over here is, border. Okay. So in border, I can, mention another color like red. Then you can see now red color is coming to the borders. Okay. Now you might have one more query that if I want to give a red color to this left people and let's say light blue color to this right people, in that way if I want to change the color, then what I can do? So here, instead of writing this blue instead of in front of this color, what you can do is I can write down this C into bracket. The first color that I would like to give is, let's say, red. And then second color I would like to give is a light blue. And then if I run this, you can see this is how it is coming. And now in this case, I would like to, be a border should be black. So you have this code in front of you and this is the graph in front of you. Please do this and then we'll move ahead. Now there are many things that you can play around it, but to create a base chart, you just need to give a bar plot into bracket A, then base chart will come and then you can add all this component. So once it is done, just tell me so that we can move ahead.
Done, sir.
Okay. So we'll move ahead. Now, if you want to use this chart, like here it is made in a R Studio, but we want to let's say paste this chart in our presentation, or let's say our report, or let's say we want to upload it on our website. So we need this chart. So there are several options to export this chart. So if you go to this section, then export is there. Just click on that. Here three options are there: save as image, save as PDF, and copy to clipboard. Now if you copy to clipboard, I've just, you know, copied it, copy plot, and I can paste anywhere. For example, here in the presentation I'm pasting it, then it is coming like this. Okay, now since my margins are very I have, you know, made my screen very zoom, so that is why it is coming like this. Otherwise it will come properly. You can also, you know, save it as an image, so JPG, PNG, TIFF, BMP, metafile, SVG, EPS, and many format you can save. And you can also change the dimension of the graph from here. Okay, and then you can save, then it will be saved as a R plot. Here you can give the name also, like bar plot. Okay, so in that way it will save. Another thing, you can also, you know, right click on the chart, and there are several options like save image as, copy image, and then this copy image address and all. So we are interested for copy image, and then we can go and press Control B. You can have this graph. Likewise, we can, you know, put our graphs over there, and then we can update our report or the presentation.
So when we save it as JPG or PNG format, within that R Studio only, it will get saved saved in the R Studio itself, right?
No. You can save it anywhere. So see, save as. And then I have used this JPG, and then I'm giving it as a bar plot. Okay. Mm. And where I want to, you know, save. So here directory is there, right? So click on the directory, and it will ask you that where you want to save. So by default, it will save in a working directory, but I want to save it on a desktop. So I'll select this desktop and then open it and then save over there. Now, if I go to the desktop,
okay,
here bar plot is there.
Suppose that I did the analysis and I want to save it in the R Studio itself, and afterwards I want to save it in my file or my paper or research paper article something. I can do that also, right? Or do I have to save it in the desktop any other?
So okay. See, you can save this R file. So here, see, I have opened a new file. So it is untitled 2 is showing. So I'll press Control S, and then I'll save it in a this session one, that is our, you know, today's material where I kept. So I'm giving it test.r. So that is the name of file I'm giving. So I've just, you know, saved it. Now if I go to that folder, you'll have this test.r. Now whenever I'll open this file, I'll have this information, this code, whatever I written over there. I just need to run this code so that I'll have the output.
Okay.
Sir, can you please repeat this?
Which one? This saving the file.
I mean, if I want to this the whatever I have done later, then.
Yeah, sure. So let me open a new file. So here I have opened a new file which is untitled this one, and I am using this library and then MASS and whatever code I am writing over here. Okay. Now I need to just you know, press Control S. As usual, we are, you know, using in any of the other programs.
Okay.
So for the first time, it will, you know, tell you that where you want to save. So I can select that on a desktop. Okay. And then this is, let's say, test.r. Now, .r, that means it is a R file. That is why the extension is R. So we usually write it .r and then save. Now, if I go to the desktop, you can see this R file is there. Now, after 6 months also, if you open this file, then you will have this, you know, library mass, whatever code that you had mentioned.
The entire project will.
Yeah, entire program and project will be there. So this file, for example, this data visualization using base package, that is, you know, I created previously, and then I had shared with you. Okay. So this is already I shared with you. So this is, I have already, you know, created someday and stored in that my directory, and then I shared with you. Now, we'll
just 1 minute, sir.
Yeah, yeah.
Can you please show that saving part? Is it from that export button, or you are showing something else that I guess?
Sure, sir. Let me repeat it. So here, whenever you want to, you know, take this chart to either report or PPT or anywhere else, there are several options. The first option is this export, right? So in export, you can say save images or save PDFs or copy to clipboard. Okay, so save images, then this image will be saved in the whatever location. So here I'm saving on the desktop, so let it be there.
All right.
Another thing is I can right click on this chart, then also there are several options like save images or copy image. So I can select this copy image there, and then I put it in the... So this is how we can export the charts once it is prepared. Okay. Now let us move ahead with our next topic, that is clustered bar chart. Okay. So here it is like this. Now here in clustered bar chart is a theoretically.
Thanks.
So in cluster bar chart, what we have understood is there are two variables, and for that we want to perform this analysis. Now these two variables are supposed to be categorical. Now here in our data set, let's say smoking habit and gender, these two variables are there which are interrelated, or you can say it is expected to be associated, and both are of categorical in nature. So what we can do, we can again make a table. Okay. In table, I can mention that DF dollar, then this let's say sex first of all, and DF dollar smoke. Okay, because there are two categorical variable, and I want to make a this matrix kind of thing. So table sex and the smoke. So if I run this, I'll get this kind of output, like female, male. So that is what the gender that is in the row, and in the column that is smoking habit that is mentioned over there. Now I will use this table to create my clustered bar chart. So to make that, what we can do, we can save in a object called, let's say, B here, and if I run this, then it is stored in a B. And now the same command I have to use, that bar plot, and then I'll be giving a B only, and you can see here this is coming like this. So please do up to this level, and then I'll explain you how to make it side by side graph, and how can we change the colors and all. Done.
Sir, I'm getting an error part over here. I don't know why. I did the same thing. We first did that thing, right? Table DF dollar sex, comma DF dollar smoke.
Right.
After that, then we saved it in the folder B, right? B less than equal less than hyphen.
Mm.
The same one, right?
Mm-hmm.
Then I pressed. Then I typed bar plot B.
Yes.
So that came, the first thing, the table female, heavy, never, occasional, regularly, that chart 59995, that came. After that, when I press bar plot B, it is showing error in bar plot B, object B not found.
Okay.
Console part.
Yeah, because you didn't run after, adding that B part. So see.
Oh, so you have to, after adding the B part, I have to control R. Control enter.
Yes. Then it will be stored in the B. Otherwise, just typing here will not.
I have to do bar plot B and then again control enter, sir.
Yeah.
Okay, yes. Okay, it's coming.
Coming?
Yeah, bar plot.
Okay. Okay. So done, everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now here, it is a stacked bar chart. Stacked means there is one on the top of other. So what we can do is we can have a side by side. So for that, we can use the argument That is beside. Beside, now here in the, you know, this section, you can read that a logical value that we have to give. So it may be either true, it may be either false. So that is the, it is a kind of a switch on and off. So let's say if false, then column height, that will be portrayed as a stacked bar. And if it is true, then columns are portrayed as a juxtaposed bars. So that is side by side, basically. So let me keep it true. And if you see now, then it is coming like this. Now the same thing I'm just quickly adding. So you can also add if you want. Then main is equal to, let's say, bar chart of sex and let's say smoking habit. After that, I'm adding this X lab. That is my, let's say, smoking habit. Y lab is nothing but the count. Okay. Now, another thing also I would like to have, that is, let's say, male and female, right? So because it is representing to the male and female. So what I can do, I can add that also. Like for that, there is a you know, argument, that is legend.text. So if I add this, and here I have to mention that first female, and the second is, let's say, male. And if I run this, I'll be having this kind of legend box is also there, like which color is representing to whom. Now here, well, you might be wondering that why my, you know, box is coming like this, because my margins are very high. So let me just, you know, zoom out and then show you how it will come in your this thing. So it is properly, it will come like this. Okay. And we can also add the color. So comma and col is equal to, let's say, we would like to give the red and let's say blue. Then it will come like this. So please perform up to this stage and then we'll move ahead. See, these are the same arguments. So if you don't want to, you know, spend time at this point of time, then also it's fine. Main xlab and ylab. That is what we just understood in this bar plot, this previous one. You can just
Sir, what is for this legend.text?
This is for, you know, putting this box over here. Like, you know, if you don't add this argument, for example, let me just comment it out, or let me show you the previous graph. Now here, from this graph, how can you say that which is representing male and which is representing female?
Okay, sir, got it.
Yeah, for that we are using that legend.text. So once it is done, please let me know. We'll move ahead.
Done, sir.
Okay. Okay, now we'll move ahead. Done, no? Okay. We'll move ahead with our next chart. So that is, let me, you know, open that file because I closed that file. So the next one is, let's say, pie chart. Okay, so let me type that pie chart. Okay, now here, pie chart is, during the theory, I explained that it is a brother of the simple bar chart. So whatever requirement is there for the bar chart, like, you know, putting a table and table is stored in some object. So we have stored one object, that is A, which is showing the left and right over there, right? So we are going to use the same information to make a pie chart. So to make a pie chart, the argument is very simple. That is pi, right? So if you write this pi, and then it is asking for the data, so that is A. And if you just run this, you'll have this pie chart. Now again, here also you can, you know, add that main and everything, but again, I'll not be, you know, repeating that. Now this is coming as a pie chart. Now if you want a, you know, boundary for this chart, then you can use this box argument. So box, open bracket, close bracket, nothing needs to be written over there, and then just enter. So it will come like this. So it is, you know, as simple as that. Please make the pie chart and then we'll move ahead.
Sir, I have a query.
Mm-hmm.
Sir, how can we manage the diagram? That means suppose there is left and right is there in the diagram. So suppose I want to classify the left and right with the colors in a different box in this diagram. So how can we do that on this type of specifications in the diagram?
You want to change the color, is it the question?
No, sir. Suppose the color blue and white are represented right and left. Okay, so I want to make a box beside this and make the statement that this color represent white and this mm-hmm. is representing right, like this. So okay. How can we configure this type of situations?
That I think you can use a label or something like that. It is a quite, you know, similar to the legend text that we have used over here. Right. So here also, like, you know, this box we are, you know, making that this is female and this is male. Since by default, it is not there in the pie chart. Why? Because if you look at the pie chart, then already these labels are given to with reference to the color. That is why it is not necessary here. But here it is necessary, because if you remove this blue and red color, then, you know, it is difficult to make out that which is female and which is male. Right, but in pie chart, yes, you can do. You need to just, you know, explore this option. There are several options, like, you know, you can see all these options. So you need to explore that, because I have not used that, so I don't have the answer. But definitely, if you just search, then you will be able to, you know, do that. For that, the right keyword or the right question is how to add legend in pie chart. So if you search like that, you will get the answer.
Okay, sir. Sir, yes. Why I am asking, because in the case of stata, we know that whenever there is a diagram, it opens in a window. And from right. This window, we can arrange the colors or the scale, whatever maybe. So that's why I am asking that, is there any this type of a situation in the R where in the diagram, or suppose whenever it is opening in a window, and we can arrange from that window other than writing comments.
Okay. So you just need to, you know, explore this pi function of this R, because I have not used it, so I don't have any ready answer for that. But yes, in R it is a programming language, so you can customize everything. So, but you need to just, you know, like manage the way how we write the code. That is the thing.
Achha, sir, in yes. continuation with a question put up by him. So yeah. You said now how to use legend text in pie chart. So where do right. we have to put this this request?
Then you need to, you know, search on the Google actually, because Google. I'll tell you that you know how to add. In that also, I'll explain you. That, you know, there is a R community actually. Why this R is popular? Mm-hmm. Because this R is available for free. That is open source. That is one situation. And another thing is, there are so many R users are there, so that you know, they can help you, because they also have some, you know, this kind of problem, and they come up with some solution to this problem. So let me just show you the simple example how to add, let's say, legend in the pie chart. Okay, now this one is stackoverflow.com. So there you can, you know, exactly get whatever you are asking. So there are so many users. So here, you know, slice and colors and everything that you can See, here the entire solution is given, but it is shown in their example. You can see the slices that they are making, then defining the colors, so that color you can change, and then whatever code that you just follow it, and then here you can see that numbers and everything is coming.
Okay, sir.
So you know, that is our community basically. They are, these are the people who are actually our user, and they are posting their queries as well as this, all these things here, so you can, you know, find the solution. Okay, so that is the concept of pie chart that we just you know, seen. After that, there is another graph that we have seen, is a histogram. Okay, so let me just press, let me just type this histogram, and if you want to see the detail of histogram, then you can, you know, put a question mark and HIST. Okay, so see, HIST, this four character I just typed, and it is coming that hist is there, right? So just you know, select this one and run this, so you can have this help over there. And you can have, you know, all these arguments that, you know, this function hist, where it is, you know, taking these arguments, and what type of arguments it is taking, so that you can, you know, see over here. And for the each argument, the explanation is given. So if you want to explore more, then you can, you know, explore from this help file. Now, a histogram is, as we discussed, it is used for the quantitative data or continuous data. Now, here in our data set, the span of writing hand or non-writing hand, that is a continuous data. So let us try to make a histogram of them. So I'll type HIST hist, and then I'll be you know, mentioning this df dollar writing hand. Now here I don't need to make a table because it is a continuous variable. So df dollar writing hand, and then just click control enter. So you'll have this kind of histogram. Now see, here main is also already taken. This xlib and ylib is already taken. Now if you want to change, then you have to mention, otherwise you can keep as it is. Now here also this color argument will work same, like col is equal to, let's say, light blue. So it will come like this. So please make the histogram, and it seems to be a normal, that is, you know, we can conclude from this, because it is symmetrical and bell-shaped curve kind of pattern we can observe there.
Done, sir.
Yeah. Okay, everyone, done?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now we'll move ahead and create a box plot for the same one, right? So,
sir, I am facing a basic problem, that is the color is still green, and it is not, I mean, last time I have done pie chart, then it was green, the writing of the. And again, this is again continuing as green, and the comment is not working.
Okay. Can you share your screen?
I mean, right now, what is violet in your the portion violet? It right. Is something that is coming green as for me.
Okay. Can you share your screen so that I can see your code also?
Yes, I can.
Yeah. Yeah. There might be a Okay, now make a histogram. Into bracket df dollar.
Yes.
why it is not coming?
Yeah, that I cannot understand.
Okay. Have you, you know, closed this one and then again open it? Is it like that?
Sir, sorry?
Yeah, but have you closed this and then again opened this one? Is it like that?
Maybe yes.
Yeah, so you need to do one thing. You just run from the library mark in the first command. First two line, you just run that.
Oh, okay, okay.
First two line, yeah, you just run that. Yeah, and now you use that histogram command, hist into bracket df dollar. Okay, and just try to write down the
what was that w
one thing this, you know, pi is, you just delete that one, pi open bracket is there, right?
Oh yes.
Yeah. So it is in a continuation of that. It might be, you know.
Okay. Got it. Okay. Maybe.
Now, if you try this,
still not working, I guess.
Actually, everything is coming as a text information because the color is green, right?
Yes.
Open a new file, not an issue. Open a new file. Control Shift N.
Control Shift
N.
Yes.
Okay. Now here just type those two commands, that library and df survey. The two commands you write and then you continue.
Library.
Then MASS, that is mass in capital. Run this. Control Enter.
Yes.
Then
df
less than sign and then yeah, survey. Yeah, now it is coming. Control Enter.
Yeah.
Now you press histogram. So yes. Yeah. And now you just enter this df dollar. Second option, that is wr hand. Yeah. And then you add the color if you want. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. There might be, you know, something has been pressed or some comma might be there. That is why it is coming.
Yes. I'm okay. I'm good.
Okay. So once we are done with the histogram, now we can move ahead with our next topic, that is box plot. So box plot. So now, you know, to see what kind of argument and how it is working, we can use this help command, that is question mark and then box plot. Okay. So you can see it is producing a box and whisker plot. And here how these arguments are taken. So that is all mentioned over there. And here the, you know, to give the formula when we are having a group. So y is a continuous variable that needs to be splitted by group. So here we have to use this kind of syntax. You can see y and then the sign of you can say tilde and then whatever group that we are studying. So that we have to give like this. So let us first make the simple box plot, that is for only one this one variable, and then we'll move to the next one. So here I'll be typing this box plot, and then I'll be writing this df dollar writing hand, and then just click OK, and it is coming like this. Right. So there are two outliers basically. That is, you know, beyond the lower limit. And this is the, you know, Q1, Q2, Q3, and then this is upper limit. So this is for the one variable. Now here we want to compare the groups. So to, you know, make it for the group, I can use this box plot. And then I'll be using this, you know, df dollar, this writing hand, because it is my y means continuous variable, and then I'll be using this tilde sign, which is shift, and then the button which is previous to the numeric one key, that is tilde sign. Okay. And then here I need to mention that I want to, you know, group it by gender. So how it should look like? So one box is supposed to be for the male, another box is for the female. And I want to check whether it is, you know, same or it is a different. So that kind of group comparison I want to make. So here I'll be pressing Control Enter, and I'll be having this kind of chart. Now here I can add the arguments like color that I want. I mean, color, you know, now you might be also having one query that how can we find the color? Like I'm mentioning light blue and red. So how many colors are there that I can mention over there? So for that, I can use colors, open bracket, close bracket. And here you can see 657 colors are there, which are supporting here. 657. So what I have done is I have just mentioned the colors.
Bracket, sir, can you show that again? I just missed that part.
Yeah, yeah, sure. So I am, you know, typing in the console. So color, C-O-L-O-R-S, colors, bracket open, bracket close, and then just run this. So you'll have all these names.
Okay, I need to type that in the console part, right?
Not necessary, but here, this is the temporary thing. I don't want to save it as a part of my program. So I have not mentioned over here. Otherwise, I can, you know, write like this, colors, and then Control Enter. Then here also, it will come as an output. So you can also, you know, write in the this script file also.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, I got it. Yes.
Yeah. Now here, let's say I orange as one color, and I'm putting it over here. And since it is, you know, taking in a form of the vector, so I'll be, you know, taking another color, which is, let's say, Oliver rep 2, rep 4, for example. Now you can see here it has changed the color. So from here you can, you know, select the color. Now if you might have a hexadecimal color, then also you can take. How? So let me show you that part also. So I'm again, you know, making this box plot of df dollar writing hand and then df dollar sex. Okay. Now here in a color argument, what I can do in the this double quote, I can also mention the hexadecimal colors. Let me take one color there. Okay, so this is the, you know, hexadecimal color of our logo. So if you, you know, look at the PPT, this color in the, you know, this line I'm, you know, just using this green color and this green color, right? So for that, the code is there. So that code I just entered in place of color. So it has come with that color. So in color argument, it is taking either name of the color out of this 654. And if you have some specific shade of the color, then you can also add this hexadecimal value in that place. Then also it will come. And all other arguments will be there, like, you know, main. So it is, let's say, box plot of writing hand span and gender. So it is coming like this. Now, another, you know, small function that I would like to tell you, that since it is a long title, so it is not coming here properly. So I would like to do one thing that, you know, I would like to mention that box plot of writing hand span and then gender and gender from here, I would like it to go into the second line. So what I have to add, I have to use this forward slash and press N. Okay, please remember forward slash and N and then run it. Now you can see from here, from this point, it has made a new line over there. My title is accommodated properly. Okay, so this is how we can, you know, customize the title, and we can also give like this. So up to this point, everybody is in line.
Sir, please, that number that you have found, can you please repeat, sir?
This numbers?
Yes, sir. Okay. Yes, sir. Okay. How can I get that range?
Yeah. So see, any of the you know, number, colors, they are having their hexadecimal values. Okay, hexadecimal values are derived like this.
Okay.
So there is, you know, basically hex and beans and everything. Okay. So this is the this transformation table basically. Now, if you want to, you know, look at the let's say hexadecimal for let's say red color. So it is hashtag and FF000. Now let me copy this and paste it in our chart. So it should generate basically a red color.
All right.
Yeah. So I'm just, you know, using this and running this. So you can see now it has come as a red.
Yeah.
So right. Every color, every shade, because see, red is a single one. But let's say there is a shades of the red. So if you, you know, change some of the value, then it will have some different, you know, colors and it's, you know, shades over there. So that you can, you know, get from this.
Thank you, sir.
Basically,
thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
So shall we move ahead?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, slowly answers are reducing.
Somewhere I got lost. I think so. I did some mistake. The earlier participant had the same problem. No, our writing were coming in green. I think I don't know. I did some error part. I think that's why.
Yes. In that case,
so I was juggling that file. Thing, and I was juggling with it. So.
Not an issue. You can just open a new file and then write there.
Okay.
Now, see in the box plot. Let us try to understand this box plot. So this is for female and this is for male. So it is, you know, it seems that on an average, writing hand span of the male is higher than the this female one, right? So here you can see the differences. This is at the lower side, median is. This is at the higher side. That is one thing. Another thing is, in male, one person is there whose writing hand span is very small, which is, you know, even smaller than the lower limit of the female writing hand span. So you can see this observation. It is, you know, below this line. So there is some, this is called an extreme case, or you can say outlier, that he is having, you know, not, he is differentiating from the, you know, the routine one or the regular observations. So it is behaving like an outlier or extreme reduce. Now here in the, you know, the female side is also there. So there are two outliers, which is having values below the lower limit, and one value which is having upper above this upper limit. That means one female or one lady is there whose writing hand span is, you know, quite more compared to all the groups of this female, and that is quite high. You know, it is as high as the 75th percentile of the male writing hand span. Okay, so this is, you know, in line with that. So this is how we can, you know, read the box plot.
Sir, so, can I share my screen? I don't know where I went wrong. Just
Sure.
Just a second. So, present now. Entire screen.
Okay, have you shared your screen?
Yes, sir. Can you see my screen, sir?
No, not yet.
Wait, just. Chrome is showing the conversation. How do I have to select this one, sir? Like the RStudio one?
Not RStudio one, but when you click on the present now, you have to select this, your entire screen. That. Your entire screen.
Yeah, I've done that.
And then in the middle, you'll see one screen. Just click on that and click on the share.
Okay, fine. Yeah, it's coming. Can you?
Now it is loading.
So where did I go wrong?
You did go wrong at color is an argument. So color is equal to, it would be there. Color into bracket will not be there.
This one.
Yeah. Color, so color is equal to.
Equals to, and then
Then just, that's correct.
It's okay.
Yeah, it's not
control run. Okay, it's covered. Okay, yeah. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
I should stop sharing, right?
Yeah, sure.
Can I choose separate color for male and female in this case?
Yes, you can do that. Let me show that also.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. So here, whenever, you know, please remember this, it is going to be very helpful. So whenever this kind of multiple operations you want to perform, at that time, argument is given in either list form or in a vector form. So I hope list and vector, that is covered during the basics of RStudio. So whenever we want to apply anything in a vector, at that time, it is written in the form of like C. Okay. So let me just, you know, remove that hexadecimal cover. And, you know, I'm using a simple color, that is red and let's say blue. So what it will do for the one box, it will first box, it will give a red. And for the second box, it will give a blue. And let me run. And now you can see here, the color has been changed. Okay. Now you need, let's say, for example, I'm taking another variable for grouping, that is, let's say, exercise group. Now you can see here, we are having three groups in exercise. Okay. Frequently, none, and some, right? So here what it has done, so we have provided only two color. So it will, after, you know, this completion of the second color, it will start again using the same color. So it will, you know, go on using alternative color. So let's say if there, now still I'm, you know, changing another one, that is, let's say, smoking habit. Now you can see red, blue, red, blue, red, blue. So it will go like that. It will go in a loop of that. Now, if you want, let's say, all four colors to be different in this case, so red, blue, and then let me keep it orange. And let's say light blue. So you can see here, all these people are having the different color. So that is how you can, you know, mention in the vector.
So just one thing, in the box plot, just down there is heavy, and there's occasional. If I want to say, see the occasional full word, just not just occasion. So how can I do that, sir? Because that sir, looks little bit clumsy. That's why, sir.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Why it is coming like that? Because if you go to this, you know, your actual data.
Okay.
Yeah, it is all mentioned right there itself. That okay, is why okay. It is coming like this.
Okay, got it.
Yeah.
Got it.
Okay.
If that data is correct, then it will be correct.
Yes. It will come correctly.
Okay, thank you.
So now our next topic is scatter plot. So let me just see if anything is, you know, missed. No, there is nothing is missed. Now let us see our scatter plot. Okay. Now to, you know, use the scatter plot, the command is very simple, that is plot. So let us see first of all what it is asking. So plot plot, and then just see. And this is very generic command, so you can use this you know, in many of the further analysis also. So tomorrow when we'll talk about this PCA, at that time we'll also use this plot, and it will, you know, take the values from the model and all. So basically, plot takes some argument like x, y, and there are, you know, several other argument, that is graphical parameter, like you can say this mean and lab and all these things. And you can also mention the type. So if you, you know, mention this x and y, and then you can type. Type P is for the point, L for the lines, B for both, and let's say C for lines part alone of B. And then O, H, so that all you can see. Now we'll just, you know, try to understand how it is done. So we'll iterate and use this one. Now I'll be using this plot command, and we have seen in scatter plot, we need two quantitative, that is continuous variable. So DF dollar, let's say writing hand span, and DF dollar non-writing hand span. Okay. And now if I run this, so by default, it will come in the form of this dots. Now here I can mention like you know, this type is equal to, let's say, L, then it is coming in a L pattern, right? So L is not useful actually in this case, but this is how you can, you know, change this. If you can, you know, press this B, then it will come in a both the way. So here you can see it is coming like, you know, the wherever this point is changing, line is also there and this dots are also coming. But here in this case, this is not useful. Only this P, that is point, by default is there, that is useful. Okay. Now, by looking at this, what we can see is there is a relationship between writing hand span and non-writing hand span. Now, here in the x-axis, writing hand span is written, and on the y-axis, non-writing hand span is written. So, you know, by looking at this graph, we can say non-writing hand span, that is our dependent variable, which is depend upon the writing hand span. In that way also we can conclude. Another thing we can conclude is it is positively correlated. That means if a person is having the higher value of writing hand, he is supposed to have the higher value of non-writing hand also, right? So one is increasing, another one is also increasing. So that is what we can conclude from this scatter plot. Now, if you want to, you know, change the colors and everything, that also you can do it from here. So COL, it is, let's say I'm putting it a red. So it is coming in a red color. Now you also, you know, would like to have some, you know, different notations instead of this round circles. You want it to be, you know, feel something else. So for that, the argument is PCH. Now see, it is not suggesting, but the argument is PCH is equal to, and then you can mention numbers. One. So one is for this circle. Let me use this two. Two is for the triangle. Okay. Now here, if you want to, you know, search, then you can see like what is the PCH. Let me try. Yes. I think there is a list of that. Yes. Can you see this?
Yes, sir.
So whenever you, you know, PCH is equal to zero, at that time this kind of square will come. If you write it one, then this kind of circle will be there. Two is equal to triangle will be there. Three is equal to plus will be there. So likewise, all these things are there. Up to 25 you can select. And here, this, you know, categories are also given. So PCH 21, that is filled circle. You can see 21, that is filled circle.
What is,
okay,
the full form of PCH? What does it, what does PCH stand?
That's very true. Initially, when I was learning, no, at that time, I was also having the confusion. But actually, I have got that full point, full form of this. Point character.
Point character. I was thinking picture character.
You know, actually here points are there, no? So we are changing, you know, these points to some other character. So that is why it is coming like this. So if I write 21, then it is coming like this. If I write, let's say 20, then it is coming like this. Now,
so the type P suggests what, sir? Type P.
That is point we are doing, right? So let me again tell you in the help file, I'll show you. So here you can see, when you mention type P is equal to, then you know, it is creating a points. When you, you know, keep it L, then it will create a lines. If you keep B, then it will create a both. So likewise, these types are also given there.
Because earlier we have written that beside it equal to T, something like that.
But that was. That was for the this bar plot, and this beside argument was taking true and false. So beside is equal to true. So that was a switch actually, that, you know,
all right.
Beside yes or no, that kind of thing. But here,
What that suggest? So what that suggest, that beside yes means?
Okay, let me show you again because I think you missed that part.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So when you create this, you know, bar plot B, then how it is coming? The, you know, male and female, that is, you know, the information of the both the gender is, you know, on the top of it. Actually, we want all this. Right. We want it side by side. So what I'll do, I will add the argument that is B site is equal to true. And now you see the difference.
Okay.
Have you got the difference between?
Got it.
So if you take this side is equal to true, then it will be side by side. And if this side is equal to false, then it will look like
false. This. Then it is the earlier picture.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Yes. Thank you very much.
Correct.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Okay. So here, by default it is P. So if you don't even type this, you mention the type, then also it will, do the same thing. Okay. Now, since everyone likes their name, so if I want to, make this point character as, let's say, Hiren, so not Hiren exactly, but H, for example. So if I, type H like this, then it will form like this. So you can try with your first letter. It will not take entire name. It will take only one character. So that is also possible to customize here in the plot. So, is it coming? Yes, everyone. Are you there doing or what?
Yes, sir.
Yes, yes.
Yes, sir. Got it.
Okay. So shall we move ahead?
Yeah, sure, sir.
Sir, I have another basic question, sir.
Yeah, please.
Sir, like we are assigning a value like A to a part of our table or function or something, and again B to another part. And if later I again assign A to other part of our work, so the previous A will remove.
Yeah, that will be replaced actually. So yes. A very small example, let me show you, because this is the basic question. So let's say A is equal to 5 that I have stored. Okay. Now, whenever I use this A, it will print 5 for me. Now, I again go and, after a few lines of code, I forgot that I have, mentioned this A. So I'll go and give it a 10. And now whenever, if I go and print this A, then it will print this 10 instead of this 5, because it will be replaced.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. And now let's say you might have another question that how can we remember that which we have values assigned? So for that, this environment is given here, right? So in this environment, you will be able to see all the variables or the values that you have stored. So here A is there, B is there. Likewise, if you have hundreds of values that you have stored, so that will be appeared here.
Okay. Yeah. This was useful information.
Yes. And another thing, like you can also get like ls command. Ls, just type, I think. Yeah. So when you type this ls, that is a list basically. Ls is its full form is list actually. So what it will return? It will return you all the values which is stored in the environment here, right? So here it is showing that A is also stored, B is stored, and DF is stored. So here also you are able to see this.
Yes.
Yeah. So that is also another function that you can get that. Okay, so now let me show you some more beautiful plot. One thing is, this is the scatter plot that we have made, and we have found that there is an association between them. There are so many numerical values are there. So for that, I cannot go, each and every time and write this much of code. So what I can do is, I can prepare a matrix plot. So how can we do that? So first of all, let me create a new data frame. So new DF. Okay, I'm giving the name new DF. And there, what I will do, I will store all the numeric values from this data. So this is also, I think, it should be covered that, you know, if you want to fetch rows and column from the data frame, then how can we fetch? Is it covered? Yes, anyone? This use of square bracket is covered?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So here I want all the rows. So what I'll do? Df into bracket, I'll put a comma, and then here I'll mentioning, like, if I, you know, write down this 2, let me just, you know, go there. If I write down 2, then what it will do? It column. Will fetch all the rows from column 2. If I want, let's say, 1, 2, 5, if I write like this, then what it will do? It will fetch all the columns, all the rows, but column 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So from here, what I will do, I want all the numeric column, which is for which I want to prepare a matrix plot. So let me try to find out that which are those columns. So here we can see the writing hand, non-writing hand. Then this is, let's say, pulse. And then this is height and the age. Okay. So let us get that one. So I would like to mention over here, in new data frame, I'll be storing these values. So C, and then the first, second, third. So second and third column. After that, sixth column. After that, nine and 11. Okay. So these are the columns which are numeric columns. So I'm saving it in a new DF. And now if I look at the new DF, then it should have all this information, but I think I committed a mistake. So that is why all this smoke and MI is coming. That is not I want actually. 2, 3, 6, 10, and 12. And now if you see the head of this new DF, then you can see here, it is coming like this. All the numeric columns are coming. Can you please mute microphone? Now, see, this is, you know, all the numeric column that we have done. Now, what we have to do, we have to use only a single command. Let me just see, that is new DF. You can see the plot command is there. And in that, we have just provided all the numeric values. Okay. So this is 2, 3, 6, 10, and 12. So you can see here, it has prepared a scatter plot for each possible pairs. Now here, let me, you know, take this to PPT so that I can explain this in a proper way by using my this writing pen. Okay, so here you can see in this graph, a diagonal is all the variable names, writing hand, non-writing hand, pulse, height, and age, right? Now here, this particular graph is showing the scatter plot of writing hand and non-writing hand, right? So this is how it is done. So on x-axis, non-writing hand is there, on y-axis, writing hand is there, right? So this is how you can find out there is a relationship between them. Now, this figure. Okay, so what it is suggesting? So it is basically an information of pulse. And this side, it is an information of writing hand. So this is the relationship between writing hand and the pulse. So we can find out that there is no such you know, pattern is observed. So there is no correlation between them. Now, if you look at this figure, then it is again like non-writing hand and the pulse, it is there. Similarly, if you, you know, look at this one, then it is height and writing hand. This one is height and non-writing hand. This is height and pulse. Similarly, if you look at this one, then this is age and this is writing hand. Okay, this is age and let's say non-writing hand. This is age and this is pulse, and this is age and the height, right? So this is how you can get each and every possible pairs of the correlation or the scatter plot. Now you might have another question that, you know, then what these charts are doing, right? So off diagonal, what they are doing, that are actually nothing but the mirror image of it. So here, this is the relationship between non-writing hand and writing hand, right? So it is the same interpretation would be there. This is writing hand and then this is the pulse. But here only the axis has been changing, right? So axis have been changing here in the bottom. So if you just, you know, read the upper triangle, then also it is perfectly fine. You can, both the triangles are providing the same information. So this is how we can make a matrix plot. Now, I think it is already 1 o'clock. So another thing I just quickly, I would like to, you know, tell you that this is all the graphs that we have used using a base package. Base package means we have not load any library to make a visualization. Now this, you know, library that we have used mask, that is to get the data only, but to make a chart, we have not used any library. So there is another package which is known as a ggplot2, very famous package. So let me show you that file. That is already there in the material. So in that you have to install this, you know, some of the required package. So whenever you open this file, it will, you know, show you notification like this. Click on install. So it will all required. It will install all the required package, and then you can call this library called ggplot2. And then in that ggplot2 library, there is one data set inbuilt, that is MPJ. Now, if you look at the MPJ data set, what it is showing, that it is showing all this thing. And further, you know, all this graph and charts that is prepared by using that data. So you can just simply go and, you know, run that like this. So if you go and, you know, run like this, then you'll have this kind of beautiful chart over there. So likewise, you can you know, use this the syntax that I have you know, given to you. And there is another library, that is library Plotly. That also you can you know, use, but currently it is not installed in my one, so it is why it's not coming. But you can, you know, install this. And the same jo abhi humne kiya, that is also already, you know, given to you in this R file, so you can just have a look at the syntax and everything. So that might be helpful to you. Okay, so that is what I wanted to convey. So yes, if you have any queries or the question, then please let me know. I'll be happy to help you. I'll be happy to answer you. And if you have no query, then you can mention no query in the chat box.
So I don't have any queries as such now, but okay. Can we get back to you when we do our own work and have
trouble? definitely, sure. Okay. See, in this presentation, already my details are given. So whatever mobile number and email ID is given, that is of mine only. So you can reach out to me on that number and email ID, since I'm also, you know, putting it into the this comment box.